Okay, so on Hard Talk today, two conversations, we're looking at new revelations emanating from the Smarties deal. And then, of course, alrighty, we're looking also at the limited registration exercise. So we have our guests seated. And let me quickly introduce them. Nana Sapong is spokesperson, Occupy Ghana. Governs Kwame Agbaja is MP Adaklu. Honorable, you're welcome. Samuel Ayepe, MP Ayusano. Honorable, you're welcome.
Thank
Nana,
you,
thanks for joining us once again.
Okay, good. All right. Let's go straight to business.
Indeed. Let's begin with you, Nana. Mm-hmm. So, what is this whole thing that we're hearing? We know that you actually called for documentation, you know, and the Smarties deal to be put out there. Mm-hmm. Now you have it, and you still are not satisfied.
Yeah, all right, thank you. Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
Yeah. We are not satisfied because we've not gotten all the documents we requested.
What is left?
The one left is that for the one that the Attorney General wrote to the Chief of Staff, the investigative report. Mm-hmm. It was part of the release that we were seeking. And when the Attorney General was giving us the documents, mm-hmm. she added that that one was a confidential and privileged document. So we cannot have it.
But we know what was contained in that. Well, we haven't seen it.
Well,
but
we haven't seen it.
Yes.
So
it was out of that advice that we realized that there had been some overbilling and, mm-hmm. you know, the recommendation that the money be paid.
Yeah.
The money has been paid.
Yeah, but I don't believe that's the only recommendation in a report like that. You don't write a report and just come up with just one recommendation that the money will be paid. If there was overbilling, that means something went wrong somewhere. Someone didn't do his work very well. Mm. So we want to know what the Attorney General's thoughts were on that particular deal that happened last year and what she recommended that government should do in that vein. So that's the only document that's left for us to get from the Attorney General.
It means that is a very critical document.
Yeah, it is.
That is what will make the whole thing complete. But why are we not following up in court? Because then you resorted to court to get this done.
Yeah,
right?
We are currently still in court. I mean, the issue has not.
If it's in court, why is it all over social media? It's all over the news.
Because the Attorney General decided to give us some of the documents as of 2 weeks ago. So it was last week that we got them. So it hasn't come to a finality yet. We still will be going to court to make sure we get that particular document also. If the judge decides that what the Attorney General is right, that it's a privileged document, then.
So the documents you have now, what are they? For those who are not following the story, what documents do you have?
Yeah, basically, they are the contract documents, correspondence between the government, the Ministry of Transport and Smarties, and public procurement, whatnot, and whatever the Smarties guys were supposed to do with their bus branding. So that's what our lawyers are currently going through to actually see if anything went wrong in that deal.
So initially, what are the initial findings?
Yeah.
How long have you had these documents, by the way?
Oh, we've had it, I think, since last week. Yeah, so they are with the lawyers.
How voluminous are these documents?
They're about 22 documents.
Each, what, single sheets, or you have?
No.
Groups
no.
of 10s or 20s?
Groups, I can't really tell. I mean, they vary.
Would it be like a ream? You put them all together?
It could be.
Could be a ream.
I have personally not seen it, though, but the briefing that I get from the lawyers is that they've gotten the 22 documents. It was done amongst the legal team and the Attorney General. So they have the documents that they are going through. They give us a briefing on what's in those documents. And those are some of the items which are on our social media page, some of the bits and pieces of that document.
Why are you fighting this on two fronts, on social media and also in the courts?
Yeah, we believe that there should be transparency and accountability. And Occupy Ghana, we started basically on social media. It was through social media that we gathered our momentum. We do most of our engagement and interactions on social media. So, yes, we would do it on social media. And the parts that need legal interpretation, we would go to the court.
But you thought it right to seek redress from the competent court of jurisdiction. Yeah. So why then do you come and put it out the way that you have done?
In the court.
Aren't you concerned that you probably might incur the wrath of the court?
No, because in the court, what we asked for were documents, not for the court to give judgment on the issue.
Okay.
So we're requesting for information and documents in the court. As to what we do with the documents, we've not sought that aspect from the court, so that when we keep it, we are going to keep it confidential or whatnot. We asked for information, and the Attorney General denied us that information in the first place. So that took us to court, that the court should compel the Attorney General to give us the information we requested. So as to what we do with the information is our business.
But you say you are still in court?
Yeah, we are still in
court. What are you in court for?
We have to settle the issue finally.
Settle what issue? You've been given your documents?
We've not gotten all the documents. But we have to go to court.
Did you specifically list the kind of documents that you wanted?
We listed. There are about 22 reliefs that we sought for. Yeah, we gave a tall list of the documents we wanted, and out of that, that particular document was also part.
Okay, and the Attorney General has told you in what way
that in writing,
they can't give you. They wrote this. They wrote to you.
Yeah, they wrote to us when they were giving us the other document.
Basically, saying that they can't give you this document because
It's a privileged and confidential information.
Okay.
So as it stands, Occupy Ghana is praying the courts to force the Attorney General to release the remaining documents.
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah.
And then what next?
As I said, our lawyers are looking through the current ones we have. When we get that ones, we also know what is in it, because we believe that there should be transparency. Whatever government does, government should make Ghanaians aware of whatever is going on. And so we would go through the documents, we will get to the bottom of it, and then if there's anything that we see that is in breach of the law, we will seek legal redress in that aspect.
And by the remaining documents, like you said early on, that advice that the Attorney General gave the chief of staff.
Yeah.
So for avoidance of doubt, what is that particular document that you would want given to you?
The investigative report that the Attorney General gave to the chief of staff.
Okay. That's the only document that you require?
That's the only one left.
Oh, the only one left?
Yeah.
Okay.
That makes about what percentage of, everything that you have received now? And couldn't that make anything out of, whatever that you're pursuing?
Well, that's what we asked for in court. And if we've not been given much enough reason, we don't believe that they should be that confidential.
Mm.
It should be public documents for all of us to know, because we don't see the national security aspect of that document.
But is that what she said in her document, that there are national security implications?
Well, if a document is confidential or privileged, sometimes you could think that maybe it has national security implications.
No, not necessarily. If my document is a confidential document, it does not necessarily mean it's a national security
implication. Since it's a public document, we feel that we should know what's in, because government came out to tell us what was one of the recommendations in. Why isn't government telling us the other recommendations in the document?
But Nana Sapong, if there's a deal between an organization and a ministry over some bus rebranding, by what stretch of imagination would that constitute a national security?
We don't have any qualms with Smarties.
Mm-hmm.
I never
suggested that you did.
Yeah.
But I want to know your thinking. Why would this be now painted as a possible national security?
I'm not saying that it's a national security.
Well, you brought the word up, sir.
Yeah, I brought it up, but I'm not saying it is categorically. It's just, I'm just throwing it out there. Maybe we don't know the real reason why she said it's privileged.
But it's in a letter. Do you have a copy of that letter?
I don't have it here.
Okay.
Is it on your Facebook page, though?
No, the letter is on Facebook page.
Why didn't you are broadcasting documents on your page? Why didn't you put that one up there as well?
We are broadcasting just snippets of aspects of the documents.
Yeah, so how come we also want to have a snippet of that correspondence so we can also see.
When the lawyers are done, we would come out with a full comprehensive.
And indeed, now that you talk about confidentiality, I'm thinking more, along the lines of relationship between counsel and their client, and how that definitely should be confidential. Don't you see that playing out?
Well, so that's why we're going to court, for the court to determine whether...
Did the court rule that particular document be released to you?
No, because the court hasn't made any ruling uh-huh. yet. You know, in the course of the case, in the course of the hearing, then the Attorney General decided that they would then release the documents to us.
Of their own volition.
Okay. Of their own volition.
Or from pressure that you brought to bear from Occupy Ghana.
Probably. Mm. So she decided to release it to us and got one of the directors at Ministry of Transport to sign an affidavit to that effect. That was on 28th April.
Mm. So why won't you wait for the court ruling then? You never know. Maybe the court might order that happens.
Yeah, so we are still in court. So I think today we even have a hearing today.
Okay.
On the issue. So probably when we go there, then we would know.
Mm. Well, I'm interested to find out what Honourable Member of Parliament for Adaklu makes of this latest development on the Smarties case, Mr. Abuja.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me on this platform. Good morning to your cherished viewers, especially those from Adaklu constituency. Good morning to my very good friend, member of my committee. And, first time meeting Nana Sapa. Well, like him, he said he hasn't seen whichever document have been released to them. Yet he's here to talk about it. They have it in their bosom. He hasn't read it. He's talking about it. I haven't even heard any document have been given to anybody. So as far as I'm concerned, I don't know anything new apart from what happened in the past, and whatever I say now is a hearsay. And I think the other time we were here, and myself and my brother, I kept saying that I don't want this country to be governed on the basis of what I read only on social media. There should be enough information there so that we don't injure innocent people's reputation unnecessarily for political gains. I think Occupy Ghana is entitled, just like any other Ghanaian, to demand what is allowable in terms of information to the public. They have the right as individuals, they have the right as a group, and they can do that. I am not aware of the reasons why, Attorney General didn't give the documents they were demanding. In fact, I don't know all the details. I'm hearing from him for the first time the kind of document they demanded. And I'm happy when you probed further, he did say that because it was going to go out as if Attorney General said there was some national security. In fact, they never said that. My medical records have no national security consequences. But I think if you were to put my medical records on your social media, I think I'm not going to be happy about it. So
we know you're not going to be happy about it.
Yeah, it's not every record. Every information doesn't have to be of a national security implication for it to be a classified or a confidential information. Maybe the lawyers can tell us which information is needed to be treated differently. But even that is not the case. But I must say that, you see, let us be frank in this country. Occupy Ghana started as an anti-government group. That is my view. You can't take it away from me. And they have always been selective in what they pursue, which is not even wrong. They have the right to decide to be affiliates of NPP or NDC, which is not my problem. But to the extent that they pretend as if they are here to do a neutral work, and I think that it's a high time they just basically say that, yes, we are an affiliate of NPP, but that doesn't stop us from getting this. Then that would...
Does that mean that if you hold the government to account, you are by necessity a representative of the MPP?
No, I don't think it's like that. In fact, even MPP members have the right to take on government. So that is why my preamble says that they...
Because you just mentioned...
Yeah, MPP, yeah, they
so
have
I wanted
the right.
to clear that up with you.
No, it's not. They are not wrong to do that. But you see, when we're talking about 3 million Ghana city, which in fact, even 1 city of state money going wrongly to the wrong hand, should be probed or should be prevented. But when we sit in this country, when, for instance, I sit here today as a member of parliament, I still don't understand the details of how EO Group got the percentage they got, 3.5% of our oil stake at the Jubilee Field, that turned out to be over $300 million. That went to two individuals, just for bringing somebody to introduce to President Kufuor. As a member of parliament, I've been digging around. I can't find. Occupy Ghana is showing us a way of how to get those informations out to the public, because I will not be surprised. Many Ghanaians don't see. I've never even seen a paper with EO Group on it before. But these people, according to the information we've got, went away with $300 million of genuine money doing business in this country. And I'm saying that maybe, Occupy Ghana are showing us a way of how to get information which otherwise was concealed from us by any other government. And I think that I'm not taking it away from them, but that, just to say that I'll be a hypocrite to think that I consider Occupy Ghana as a neutral body looking to just make Ghana better. I think they are.
There are a lot of pressure groups. We have NDC, of course, pressure groups.
Exactly,
as well.
Exactly.
And like Kafi put exactly. that question.
And there's nothing wrong with that. It's a democratic country. It will be better in this country when people genuinely look. This is our political affiliation, so that the ordinary person doesn't get confused about.
Why are members of your party so sensitive to attempts at exposing the truth behind arrangements, deals, and then you have to go back to the past talking about? Why are you so sensitive?
No, we're not sensitive to it at all. I'm just saying that if Occupy Ghana want to do a good job, I'm just giving them one other thing that. They are established, they've got lawyers, they are doing investigation. I'm just saying that, yes, it is important to look for how the 3 million Ghana Cedi was expended, rebranding buses. Mm-hmm. I am saying that as a Ghanaian, I have, and a member of parliament, I have been trying to find out details of how EO Group got the ability to get away with $300 million.
Occupy Ghana wasn't formed. It wasn't formed at that time. So we are getting distracted from the issue. Let's deal with Smarties.
Mr. Boja,
they can't help you. I don't think they can help you. They were not formed at that time. They were not formed at that time.
In fact,
the group was years ago.
The $300 million was paid just a few years ago.
Okay, Mr. Boja, let's stay focused. Let's deal with the issue. If you're done with your submissions, I want to move on.
Yeah, well, I'm done. Like I'm saying, I don't know any more details about Smarties. Unfortunately, I thought he would have come here with some details, but he's in his preamble. He said that he hasn't even seen the documents that were released to them. You asked him directly. He said he hasn't seen them. So I am not sure whether he or myself are in a position to talk authoritatively about the new so-called revelations.
Your comments.
Good morning to your viewers, especially those in the Nigerian constituency. I read that the court had given order that the Attorney General, and for that matter, the government should release some documents to Occupy Ghana.
That's Citizen Ghana.
That is Citizen Ghana. Yeah. Okay, that's different from Occupy Ghana. Yeah, so I think I now have the right information. But my concern is that the Honorable Member is a member of Parliament. And in our standing orders and the constitution, if you want information, you can just put a question to the finance minister or who's in charge of any ministry to provide information to parliament, and that minister can say no. So if you think the EIB group that you're talking about, you will want information from
he didn't
them.
Say EIB. EIB is us.
We beg you. We haven't seen $1 of that $300 million. We beg you.
I'm sorry. So
point of
correction. Thank you very much for that.
You just put a question through the Speaker of Parliament to the minister, and the minister will then come out with the details. So you can do that. You need not to be like the Occupy Ghana to go to court and get this information out. It's important we get this information. I am a member of the Rules and Transport Committee, and my colleague is also a member. We were there together when this issue came out at the committee level, and some of us were surprised as how can 3.6 million Ghana cedis would be used for just branding. The extracts from the information.
I became a member after
that. Yes, okay, yes. Right, you are right.
So haven't been briefed then?
Never had any official
briefing. What happened was that we have the oil fund being set aside, part of it being set aside for selected ministries for infrastructure or capital investment for that. And Minister of Transport happened to be part of that, those ministries that had opportunity to get that infrastructure or capital investment fund from the our oil money. And then when the estimates, that the 2016 budget estimate was given to us to have a look at, we saw that we're in charge of two ministries. We're in charge of Ministry of Roads and Highways and the Ministry of Transport. And all the two ministries are beneficial of that fund. So when we saw the money given to the Ministry of Roads and Highways as compared to what the Ministry of Transport had, we saw that the Ministry of Transport money has then been reduced drastically. So we find out why, and we got to know that, no, part of that money has been taken at source, to SMART. And when you say at source, it means the deduction was made before the money was paid to the ministry. So I'll be happy to see contract document that had been given to Occupy Ghana. Because some of us were the view. And when I asked the minister at the committee level, she said, no, I don't have any information on that. And on the floor of the parliament, same question was put, and she denied. So today, if they've been able to get contract documents that was between the ministry on SMARTIS to Occupy Ghana, I would love to see that document. I would be grateful if we put that document to the public domain for everybody to read. But at the time that we started debating, at the committee level and on the floor of the parliament, there was no document like that. So we should know who manufactured this document. I was of the view that that contract was a verbal contract that somebody asked and the money was deducted. So if today we have documents that shows contract between SMARTIS and the ministry, some of us...
You actually requested for the documents, but it wasn't available.
It wasn't available. The minister, on the floor of parliament, you can go for the Hansard. But the minister said, I don't have any document in that. So
today, which of the ministers is
there? The female, the Fatima.
Okay.
At the day, the presentation, the day that we presented and approved the 2016 budget for the Ministry of Transport, she said she had no document in connection with that. So today, if the document has come out, some of us would love to see the document. Also, I want to occupy Ghana. And as I said, I've also put in a parliamentary question to find out. Because as an automobile engineer, if you are going to buy even one vehicle from Toyota, from whatever, you choose the color that you want. I want white car, I want red car. And then if you ask for white car, the car must come white. You don't order 216 buses. Actually, the buses were supposed to be 200 buses. And then 116 of them came. They came and we have to repaint the vehicles. The vehicles were not bought at the showroom. They were ordered. And when you order the vehicles, you must order the vehicles with the colors that you want. If you want the vehicles to appear in Ghana colors, you state in the contract. So that when the contract document will come, it will indicate specifications, what you want the vehicles to look like. You don't bring the vehicles here, and then you say you pay money to SMARTIS to repaint the vehicle. So the extra that I've seen from the Attorney General's report to the Chief of Staff, I've seen an extract, not a full document, that part of painting, repainting of the vehicle has been considered as the money that should be retained with SMARTIS, of which I think is not proper. If SMARTIS ought to repaint the vehicles, that must be paid by the manufacturer and not from the taxpayers' money and not from our oil money. So this is something that we must all be concerned and then find out that, is that what people said, that the oil is not going to be blessed by the curse? Is that how we think we can use our oil money? If you look at the estimate of the Ministry of Transport, that money was here by purposely to construct rail lines for us. But someone decided that 3.6 million cedis of that money should be taken for rebranding. I was a workshop manager for Metro Mass Transit. And during my time, what we did that we prepare the surface and sell them to advertising companies to advertise.
Which is happening
now.
It's
expensive.
It's happening today.
We see advertisements in the
papers. There's an ad today for exactly what you're talking about.
So this
for MMT.
At the committee level, I said that we can make money out of these buses. When you advertise for buses, moving buses, it's more expensive than billboards. That's stand at a point. So why is it that instead of making money out of this, we are rather spending money? And you see, when I was the workshop manager, we were able to generate enough money for washing and certain aspects that we did not go into the main process of the company to get these things done. So at the floor of the house, I raised this issue. And it is important that we don't politicize issues like this. It is our oil money. You don't politicize it. Let us look at it. The fact that the minister has resigned, should we end it? As the smartest, Occupy Ghana just said,
Nana Sapong
just said, you see, it means somebody didn't do his work well. You see, why was it that as soon as the thing came out, people started putting documents together to prepare a document backdating for somebody to sign?
So for you, you think that's what has happened?
It's because the minister said, I had no document.
Nana Sapong, you have received the documents.
So where from these documents? We must find out who prepared them.
Oh, but you haven't seen these documents now.
Yeah, but the fact that my lawyer has gotten the documents, he's giving me extracts of that document. I wouldn't doubt what my lawyer is telling me.
Okay.
And those are the extracts we put on our social media page.
Now, and I'm glad you've talked about what your lawyer has told you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what would be your response if the Attorney General stands her ground and says, look, the information that you are seeking, this last document that you want, falls within the domain of attorney-client privilege, and it's privileged information, you cannot get this information from me.
Well, if the court sides with the Attorney General, fair enough, we will still go ahead using the others that we have, because even with those documents...
But the court knows that when you have relations, conversations between attorney and client, you cannot enter that domain.
Well, so that's why we're in court. We do not believe that... We believe that maybe it should be a public document, but the Attorney General believes that it's a confidential and privileged document. If... the court determines that the Attorney General is right, we cannot have it.
Does your whole case rest on what is inside this particular document?
Our whole case doesn't rest on it, because even so far with the extracts that we've gotten from our lawyers, I mean, there is something in there which shows that something went bad.
Tell us.
It points to some wrongdoing.
Yeah, we are curious. Let us know.
Yeah, I will start that... In the first place, the buses were sent to Smarties for branding as far back as May.
Of which year?
Of last year, 2015. Mm. And there was no contract at that time. They were given to Smarties to do the rebranding. It was only after 2 months...
Who gave the buses to Smarties?
The Ministry of Transport.
Mm.
It was 2 months after Smarties had completed the job that the ministry wrote to Public Procurement Authority requesting that they sole source the contract to Smarties, after the job had been done. And it was signed by the chief director on behalf of the minister.
Mm.
Yeah. And they gave 4 reasons as to why they wanted to sole source the contract to Smarties without even stating that the job had already been done in that letter. And I'll go through some of them.
Yeah,
there was briefly. One reason that they said it was a matter of urgency, that it was the buses were purchased under a social intervention program.
Mm-hmm.
And so they needed to brand it quickly, and the buses that came were not inconsistent with the ministry's branding policy, which we do not know what branding policy that is. And so by saying so, that means the colors that the buses came in were not what the ministry wanted. And if, as Honorable said, if you're going to purchase a car, you specify the colors you want them. You don't let the car come in before you say that you're now going to repaint the cars. There was another one to which has to say that it was needed to avert a major national security threat.
The buses?
The branding.
The branding was
needed to be done in sole sourcing. The branding was needed to be sole sourced to avert a national security threat.
What does that mean?
Exactly. That's the whole point. We do not get it because, according to the letter from the ministry to the Public Procurement Authority, they stated that as at the time transport fares had gone up, so there could be a possibility of public agitation.
But
so
I'm not cutting you. They kept those buses there for almost 6 months. Some of us at the committee level ought to put pressure on the minister before the buses were released on the street. It was right sitting in front of on the forecourt of Parliament for almost 6 months. So what if we want to brand the bus? When I was with Metromas, at times we do pre-delivery inspections at the port. So as soon as we defy somebody's in DVLA, we get DVLA officials at the port preparing and registering vehicles. And the next day we put them on the street.
So that they get on the road as quickly as possible.
So coming to put the buses at the forecourt of the Parliament for almost 6 months, then we put out this statement. You see, at times, I don't know, they raise issues For debate, that should have been so simple. There was no need for side debate. Some of us don't get it. Don't raise doubt in people's mind. And because the parties were kept there for almost 6 months. So why then should you come out to say that you needed, if that is exactly anything to go by, why don't you come and keep the buses in front of parliament for almost 6 months?
All right, we're wrapping up this conversation and move to the second one on the limited registration exercise. But yes, let me quickly pick your thoughts.
Yes, I agree with my brother that we should be able to derive some commercial value from the branding of the buses.
Indeed.
But this is at the back of Metro Mass in the past. That is a picture of President Kufuor. It was paid for.
Ghana Assisted
decided to buy the space.
Let's have a look at
advertise. They were paid for. You can go for DVA records and see that these things were paid for. I can speak to authority.
My brother,
it was paid for by Ghana at 50 Secretariat.
And who constituted Ghana at 50 Secretariat?
A bunch of NDP members. A bunch of NDP members. Is there any record of payments?
The money was voted for Ghana at 50. And they decided to use part of money to advertise on
so,
the bus.
So NDP allocated issue, money and just spent
the
it.
The issue is not about whether... In any case,
I kept very quiet when you were making your presentation. Don't take my space. I was very quiet.
What I'm trying to say
is that it is not true, because as far as I'm concerned, there is no record of MPP paying for the pictures of President Kufuor on the buses. Of course, I don't have problem with the former president's images on the bus. You see, what it gives us is more than money. It probably gives education.
We don't know the full details.
Exactly. You see, the minister, the minister comes to parliament to, defend her budget, and you ask her to show you contract of something in her ministry.
Why not?
My brother knows why that not? When isn't, you want specific that information, that. From a minister, you go directly to it and you give him or her time to bring you that information.
So she was unable to bring that information.
Exactly. That never meant.
Did she then come back the document?
At the committee level?
No.
See, a week or more before the issue was brought to the House.
Did the document ever come? Did it ever get to Parliament?
We never. I am not aware of anybody, any record in Parliament asking the minister to bring the contract document of Smarties.
But you said you were not on the committee.
No, he said in Parliament. No, I wouldn't have been on the committee.
When the issue was raised, I stood up.
I'm not going to allow you to just take my this thing. Meetings are ad hoc. When we meet and we ask a question, and then somebody says, I don't have it, you can either tell the person, we are giving you this specific time to bring it. But if that elapses, the person that is not obliged to come and call you back and give it to you. And secondly, let's face it, there are people watching this program. Contracts are not always written at the same time, depending on the nature of the procurement. It's a fact.
Can you actually have a contract 2 months
before it is written?
I can go to site and vary a nature. Listen. And vary a nature of a procurement document or a contract given to a contractor on site, i.e. build an extra or open an extra window, which is not part of the decision. I can give that verbal instruction to a contractor on site.
Granted.
I can go back and put that in writing.
But this is a case where there was no contract.
No, you see, after 2 months. Hold on.
According to what we heard.
No, what you heard, and I'm telling you that I am not aware that the minister said that no contract existed. You see, because what they are trying to do is to impugn the fact that there was no contract and later somebody went and cooked up a contract.
What are your documents saying, Nanasapong?
That was what, because the buses were handed over to Smarties in May.
Mm-hmm.
And you go in August to public procurement requesting that they should allow you to sole source bus branding contract. The job had already been done. At that point in time, you cannot do an open tender. So the best thing to do is to do a sole source. Whilst it has already been done. Why is it that at the time that the buses were being branded, there wasn't any open tender for all companies to bring in bids? But you gave it to Smarties to do it 2 months before it went to public procurement. And public procurement also approved of it within 24 hours.
Okay, so for you, the procurement process has
procurement
been breached.
The procurement process was breached.
The hard facts.
And you have 30 seconds.
We want to wrap up on this, please.
People find it difficult to say was that when the issue was raised at the committee level, Madam Jifa Ativo was at loss. You see, this woman had been forced to resign just to save the face of the government.
You see, you make sweeping statements. The money was
the point of departure between I and my brother all the time.
Sweeping statement without a fact.
She had that money had been taken for the first time. Look, at the committee level.
For God's sake, this woman.
Who took the money? Somebody might be held responsible. We shouldn't punish Madam Jifa Ativo for nothing.
On that note, Nana, you haven't told us.
She just made a statement that the lady was forced to resign. You make sweeping statement without facts.
Let's off it.
Honorable members, kindly allow us. Honorable members,
you have any evidence
that money had been taken?
Have you got any evidence that he was forced to resign?
Yes.
Hold on. I'm asking you, have you got any evidence that he was forced to resign?
When you pull out the FBA account document,
you made a sweeping statement that she was forced to resign. Have you got any evidence to that effect?
But do I have to get evidence?
As a member of parliament, don't you need evidence to talk? Do you just talk because you
resign simply because she resigned to save the face of your government, and that is all.
Nana, what will you do should you lose out on this case?
We will still work with the other remaining documents that we have if it's deemed that truly they are confidential and shouldn't be given to us. And we wouldn't say that we've lost out on the case because so far, of all the releases sought, that's the only one that is left. So we don't consider it as a loss in anything. The Attorney General conceded and gave
it. If it is only and not that critical, why are you still pursuing it?
Well, it's part of it. It's part of the reasons why we went to court. So if you do not get it, fair enough. We will just go ahead.
And what's the end game? What is
the end game is to get to the logical conclusion of the whole point, to see what actually happened.
I read logical and legal conclusions.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Because, for instance, with this, to avert national security, I mean, it doesn't make, sense to me. I do not get the connection between the branding of buses would avert a national security threat. So that's one aspect. And the legal aspect is the maybe procurement issues that were breached.
All right.
Or that could possibly
and you go to court today?
Yeah, we're going to
court. All right, today, let's find out how things go in court.
All right.
Nana Sapong is a spokesperson for Occupy Ghana. And after all, in 60 seconds, we go into limited registration blues, as Beso has been describing it.
Well, that's what the dailies report.
Give us a limited smile.
A U.S. Department of Defense official says its Navy warship sailed close to a disputed reef in the South China Sea days after China warned criticism of its claims in the crucial waterway would rebound like a coiled spring. Bavarian radio reports a man attacked passengers with a knife at a train station in the Munich area in southern Germany early, leaving 4 people with life-threatening injuries. U.S. officials say President Barack Obama is considering whether to lift a 3-decade-old arms embargo on Vietnam as he weighs calls to forge closer military ties with Hanoi against concerns over its poor human rights record. German data shows industrial output fell more than expected in March, but exports posed a surprisingly strong increase, pointing to a mixed performance by Europe's largest economy at the end of an overall solid first quarter.
All right, so, well, thanks for staying. And if you just joined us, we're still live on GH1 TV and around the world on GH1TV.com. This is GH Today, and it is the Heart Talk segment. Early on, we had that conversation about the new revelations, you know, coming out of the Smarties bus rebranding deal. Now we're talking the limited registration exercise that just ended. Calls, of course, to extend the exercise, there's some that suggest that that's not necessary. There are those who think it should indeed be extended. There are those who are not too sure exactly what to be done. But let me come to our honourable members quickly. Now, considering the fact that yourselves, you have your own constituencies, let's look at the experience, you know, or indeed what the evidence that came out of the exercise from what you witnessed,
well,
do you think that it should be extended,
but,
or we're just done?
But for my conscience, it was cool. Yes, we record very few incidents, not so serious ones. At the latter part, we were even having one person registering at the center per day. So I think it's done. But the fact that Ayinsuano will not request for extension does not mean that all is done and all is well. Looking at the reports that we receive from other areas and other centers, it's important. Ayinsuano yet paid our settlement, having dotted communities sharing one center and all that, as I put it the other day, we may end up differentiated from people, other people from getting their name in the register for, and also subsequently getting the being voted in vote in 2016. I would not say that all is well, because we go to Ayinsuano today, we will still have some people who, for one reason or another, may not be able to register, especially because of a distance and all that. But looking at what happens in Legon and other areas, I'm of the view that we should either get extension, not across the country.
What happened in Legon?
Well, the report we're having that the machines sent there weren't enough, and then people, the students were queuing, and some of them, I've heard a voice from some of the SIC and some of the students who were saying that they were not able to get opportunity to register because the machines were not enough. They had one machine to start with, later on one was added, and a third one was added, but it was then too late to contain the situation. So some of the students were not able to get their name in the register.
They never made time to go register.
And especially, yes, yeah. You will not even get all the people, even if you extend it to 100 days.
Indeed.
Not everybody will register. But we are talking about a situation where somebody is prepared to register and actually gone to the center, and because of time, he wasn't able to get his or her name on the register. That is exactly what we are talking about. Because if you give 100 days, for people to go and register. After 100 days, you will still have some people who will not have their name in the register. Mm-hmm. So what I would suggest is that we should look at those areas that we can send the machine there. We are looking at a continuous registration process whereby as soon as you attain the age of 18, you move to the district office or the electoral commission and get your name in the register. I think we should push there. So the limited registration exercise will be for only those who have traveled and for one reason or the other, maybe at a point in time they decided not to register, now they've decided to register. And so that limited registration will not be anything that will be pressure will be put on it as we are seeing now. So we must try to implement that and make sure that as soon as you attain the age of 18 with your birth certificate and other national ID, show that you're a Ghanaian, you can just walk to a district registration office of the EC to get your name in the register.
So indeed, you agree with your party, the NPP, that says that this has to be extended to areas where...
Not across the country, areas, specific yes. areas where we're not... We have 40 machines in some areas. Some areas, there were fights, confusion. They ought to end the registration for a day or from hours. And these are areas that I think if we get a machine there for a mop-up.
But the NDC actually says that, listen, and you talk about EC electoral areas, you know, in the district, that if you didn't get to register or participate in this limited registration exercise, you could just now walk to any, you know, electoral commission, you know, offices in your district
and
get registered.
Exactly. If the electoral commission have put up that measure and are implementing that, then of course it's another way of
so that will work for you.
Exactly. Why not? If indeed you want your name to be in the register, you can walk to the district office and get it registered.
It's not compulsory, by the way.
Exactly. That is how you can walk. That somebody will come and put you to the center to get your name in the register. But what I would suggest is that for the tertiary institutions and areas where the EC thinks that I was listening to the voter regional director of the Electoral Commission, who said that, yes, indeed, he agreed with those who are calling for extension of the days in some areas. So I think it's a good call. And then
Honorable Governor Sambuja.
Well, I would say that I'm not an election expert. Whatever the Electoral Commission decides, of course, I'm ready to oblige. I think generally It was a peaceful exercise. The first few days, you hardly will see anybody at the registration centers. And then towards the last day, everybody rush in. It's a cultural thing. When we were all in school, we wait when it's a few days to exam. We all want to cram in everything. And I agree with my brother when he said, even if you give 100 days, there will be some people who will come around and say that we needed extra time to register. The thing is, if you see the numbers, this thing is not cheap on the pockets of Ghanaians. I mean, from the taxpayers' point of view. So there has to be a cutoff point. And I think that it went on generally. If you were to start to say that Legon should have a listing because of faulty machine, then everybody will start raising their hand here. And then before you realize, the whole thing has to be done everywhere again. And that is why it's actually a limited exercise. It's not a main distance. But I mean, people had opportunity to organize themselves to do these days. Some chose to be slapping my colleagues in Kumasi and instead of organizing themselves to get these things through, they decided to be assaulting my colleagues.
The man throws a jab.
And if the time closes and you want extra time because you spend a few days slapping
the
people.
NDC.
I've not finished.
The jabs they throw.
I've not finished.
Not that. You see, we I don't know why they are trying to prevent more than
we were
their name in the register. Are they afraid? If you have, you think you are going
you are becoming unexpected in this. You simply don't
left and right,
you simply don't allow that you've built your co-panelists to make their point. Don't
then,
jump in.
And then you are a gentleman.
Don't be doing that.
You. If I happen to be
don't,
in your
don't
shoes,
be doing that. I'd
rather
you see,
act
you think
all
that you are winning by doing that, but I could also be disrupting. When you have your time to talk,
let's allow him.
When you have your time to talk, you're becoming an expert in this. Don't do it.
Please.
You see,
take,
we don't
be naughty.
I am saying that.
You see, we are discussing an electoral commission issue.
You started saying Akifo was forced to resign. Was it part of?
He's referring to one to me. And the slap that
listen, I am saying that we all had 10 days, so we all planned for it.
Yeah.
The only reason some people could ask for extra time was because they failed to plan and they were busy assaulting my colleague in Kumasi. And then guess what? Everybody, their party echelon was clapping for that. They're saying that even if you fail to comply, they'll beat you up. And if they beat you up, I'll take them to court on your behalf. What I'm basically saying is that
isn't he kind?
I don't think they're saying.
If I respond, you say.
Oh, you will respond.
Please allow him.
I'm happy nobody beat you up anyway because you are a very good friend of mine. I think that the exercise went on quite well. The process is not even completed. We are going through the challenge hearings now, so it's not like we are even done. So to say that we should extend the time, we just probably. Going to, but whatever EC decides, I think I would comply. But I don't think we have a strong case of just continuing like that. And Legon alone, in fact, I agree that every single Ghanaian who wants the opportunity to register. But I don't think using Legon alone
should
is
be
enough.
An example. Listen, let's talk about foreigners. Let's talk about minors. I'm reading reports from Sammy Nkrumah saying that some 7,000 people registered, including Ivorians in the Jomoro constituency. What's your experience? What are you hearing? Are you hearing of minors and foreigners inserting their names into our electoral
I think she's been caught in the bag of Dr. Bawumia when he said that about 700 or 70,000 people,
70,000, yeah.
And we are yet to see the rest of the people. In fact, Dr. Bawumia was virtually in the whole Volta region on Sunday monitoring. The point is, Honorable Sammy Nkrumah made an allegation. You see, she's doing exactly what my brother here is fond of doing, throwing things out. In this country, Dr. Farijan ever said something. Evidence is a hallmark of the game. If you have any evidence that, look, and in any case, I find it difficult. I've had six colleagues of mine who I was living in London with, who took a flight, came through Kotoka to come and register. Nobody saw anything wrong with it. But the mere fact that a Ghanaian lives in Cote d'Ivoire, a Ghanaian lives in Benin, a Ghanaian lives in Togo, has become like a scare thing. I don't understand it. Ghanaians, before the boundary between Togo and Ghana was drawn, Ghanaians between Aflao and Lomé were living, as one family. There's somebody's bedroom in Lomé, and his living room in Aflao. So where is this scare factor? They said, even if somebody comes from Togo, all you need to do
is to check whether the person have got the right to register.
Should so minors be arrested?
Pardon?
Should minors be arrested? One MPP chairman said that minors should be arrested if they are in their
names. What does the law say about juveniles? I'm not sure whether you can, if the law says arrest them, why are they not arresting them? I mean, they know the law. If you think that the law allows you to go and register them, arrest them because they want to register, arrest them. Okay. NDC is not afraid of that. And I'm just saying that it is not an issue for NDC at all. Whatever the EC wants to do, let them do it to get us the register.
All right, I think we can wrap up.
Would you also subscribe, though, to the continuous registration
exactly
exercise? That
in most advanced countries, like I've made this example before. If I turn up in, if you and I turn up in UK
but
now...
But we are not advanced.
Oh, no, no, it's a very simple thing.
Are we advanced?
Provided you are from Ghana, which means you are from Commonwealth country,
yeah,
you are going to UK legitimately as a student or something, you call your local council. I am Koju Mensah, living at so and so address. I want to add my name to the voters register. In 3 days' time, they send you a form, you put your name on it, and your name is added.
But they have a national identification
document. I stay in UK. Nobody has ever forced me to get any national ID before. Never.
But they don't they have their national health insurance number, which
but that, in fact,
operates there is to, for your information.
That information is not you even know, linked up in the UK. It's a big debate. The UK cities, some agencies wanted to link your hospital ID number, your national insurance number and everything. They kicked against it. They said that data in the hands of a government can be a breach of their decision. So privacy. They never did it.
Okay.
So in UK, you can never find at one source your NHIS number, your, how do you call it, your social security. You can never find it.
Okay.
They are a lot of different agencies.
We need to learn from them. Okay, you have 1 minute.
Oh, but he had an issue about manners and...
You're reducing time.
It's not 10 seconds. I don't even get it why the NDC will try to get people... We are not saying that they shouldn't get Ghanaians outside Ghana to come and register. Mm. They are getting us wrong.
Mm.
Ghanaians, we have Ghanaians who live in Cote d'Ivoire, fishermen that cross to Cote d'Ivoire, Togo, and if they are coming home to have their name in the register, what is wrong with that?
Nothing.
We are talking about those who are not Ghanaians.
Okay.
That the NDC is aiding them to come. I was expecting you to see... To also have in your list for discussion $250 million that are found in a private account in this country. And if we hear this, definitely, Ghanaians will not vote for you. So you end up looking for foreigners who may not have this information and that will influence their vote to get their name in the register and vote for you. But indeed,
that's
if
your
you
job,
know,
is it?
Mr. Tucker says that it is that investment on behalf of the country.
This has gone into a private investment. You see,
Mr. Tucker says it's investment on behalf of the country. Let's not.
It is important that Ghanaians here, those in Ghana, who are privy to this information, that $250 million has gone...
You said it how many times?
And somebody is getting the interest out of it.
No, the interest is to
where
the Ghana Investment Fund.
It should be, there should be
30 million Ghana
citizens. Somebody should tell us where that money is. Why is it that you came to Parliament saying that I want Eurobond, 1 billion, and I want 25% of that money to infrastructure fund?
Okay.
You are only contractors who have not been paid. Why can't you take that money and pay the contractor? I decided to put the money in a private bank.
No, the money was not meant.
You are a member of parliament.
You are a member of parliament. The money was not meant to pay contractors. You know that.
Infrastructure development.
No,
brother,
let's educate the public. Was that money meant to pay contractors?
It's for infrastructure development.
But
contractors have built infrastructure for it. We haven't paid them. So if you have got money for infrastructure development, pay them. So that is the same thing. It's the same thing. If you put M and Kobe all to one soup, it's still a soup. The most important is that you've gone for money to build infrastructure. People have
fund,
built infrastructure for us
that we haven't
paid them.
It's
put it in that fund.
My brother, when you award a contract, you state the source of funding.
We are saying that $250 million Ghana.
We have never earmarked itself in a private
account.
It's not true.
Where is
it's not true. That is another lie of Dr. Baunia. He is becoming a chronic liar and you should be worried about it.
I heard that
Dr. Baunia is becoming a chronic liar.
That money has been to Ghana
infrastructure fund. Comments on this platform. I'm sorry.
Because it's not true.
Honorable members, listen.
Can you give us 1 minute without interruption?
That is a wrap.
No, we don't give you any time. Your time is up.
I just like to say a very big thank you.
Where is that money?
Honorable Ayepe. Honorable Ayepe, thank you. Thank you so
welcome.
Much. All right. So Honorable Ayepe is MP Ayesuano. And of course, Honorable Gavins Agboja is MP for Adaklu. And well, that ends our conversation.
I just feel like having some
food.
That's soup. That's soup you're talking
about. Right?
What is in the soup again?
Emmanuel, Kobe, whatever. It's all a soup.
Snails.
At the end of the day, snails.
It is Tuesday Business Unlimited happening with an amazing young woman. And that is happening on our show.
Oh, can she do
and
her
of
show?
Course, very interesting stuff happening with Ajasapong as well. News Extra and the like. You don't want to miss it. GH Today Live on GH1 TV.